Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Working on the historical, not just the plain clock.
Good morning to everyone.
Morning.
Before we start a meeting, I'd like to ask Commissioner Lashley if he would give our invocation.
Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we just come to you at this time, thanking you for all the many blessings you have given us. We just praise your holy name and lift you up above all names. And we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for all the things that you have done for this nation and this state and this county. And all these things, we thank you and praise your name. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Bill. We have one gentleman signed up for public comments. We ask that you yield to comments for about 3 minutes. It's Mr. Al Greer.
Good morning, Commissioners. Basically, I'm just here to ask you all to please respond to the questions that we posted to you at the last evening meeting, and to see if you could please respond to those questions at the next commissioners meeting in 2 weeks, which would be a pretty much a large meeting, in reference of that 287G on the questions that we posed about the EMOU and the committee that we would like for the for you commissioners to enact in reference in conjunction with the sheriff and so forth. Based on that, we hope that to hear good news from all of you and from the board at the next commissioners meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
What's the status of his request? I don't know. Well, I don't want this to come up next week and let's not have something here. I mean, I'm going to solve this thing once and for all. Is there anything we're doing, supposed to be doing for him?
We haven't been given instructions to do anything, Commissioner.
I thought I would meet with the sheriff and just gauge his interest in this. See where we might can go from there. I know there's Wanna County. I got an email on Prince William County, I think, and I'd be happy to share that with the board on something they set up at the beginning of that program. And this is a Republican board, and they all agree that it might would be a good idea. So I'll have Pat distribute that email. But I thought I'd just run that by the sheriff and gauge his reaction to it, and we'll just see if the board has any interest in it. But and we'll try to find out how that program is going up there.
Come here, Prince William, Virginia.
Yeah.
Yeah, Clyde and I are going to a seminar type meeting in Raleigh. What's the date of that?
September 19th.
September the 19th, and Prince William County officials are going to be there.
Okay.
Yeah, and there's also going to be a legal advisor that advises people across the United States what can be done and what can hold up in court and what's something that we can entertain as well further. So I hope we can have what you
wait to after that seminar.
I'm sorry?
Maybe we'll just wait to that after that.
Well, I think it'd be a wise idea because that meeting is pretty important for those that will go. Again, it's the officials from Prince William County, Virginia, and they've enacted about 11 ordinances, if I'm not mistaken. Not resolutions, but ordinances. There's a big difference. And also, there is a legal, I've already said it, an advisor that works nationally to advise counties and cities what they can and cannot do. Further, you know, beyond 287G for that matter.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Forward to seeing you again.
Let me ask a question. Is there any reason why we shouldn't have the MOU on the website? I think that would answer a lot of questions for a lot of people that are concerned.
Oh, there's no reason at all.
Can we put it on the website?
Yes.
County website. That would be
thank you. Hey, next on the official agenda is our naming of the park at Glencoe. Brian?
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
For you this morning, requesting that you review and approve a proposed name for our park property up at Glencoe. Thought I'd give you a brief update on where we stand with that facility. To date, the county has acquired approximately 24 acres that we actually own. We're preparing to enter into an agreement with the state of North Carolina to add another 11 and a half acres to that property. It'll serve as a buffer around the village and the park. That leaves approximately 22 acres to acquire in the future. These acquisitions have been made with $330,000 worth of grant funds, some from Clean Water Management Trust Fund, others with the Natural Heritage Trust Fund. And we're currently in the process of spending roughly $110,000 toward development. These funds are coming from the conversion of Glen Raven Park. The department has set and a proposed opening date of this property for October 11th, which is a Saturday. We'll be sending out more information about it. But in the interim, as we get closer and closer to October 11th, we need to come up with an official name for the property. We're proposing Great Bend Park at Glencoe. As you can see in your package, this derives from language that was on the original deed for the mill at Glencoe. The surveyor in the mid-1800s used on the deed stated that the property was located at the Great Bend of the Hall River, which if you look on a map of the Hall, it's a giant loop as the river turns back toward Burlington. Our staff, the Recreation Advisory Commission, City of Burlington, the mill developer, we've consulted with all these folks about this proposed name, and everyone feels like it has a good historical connotation, and it also speaks to one of the major features of the park, which is the Hall River. So I'd put that to you at this time, ask you to consider it, and if you believe it's appropriate for the park, to vote, and we'll go ahead and move on it.
Okay.
I'll make the motion that we name it Great Bend.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your work out there.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next is our work first, our county plan. Ms. Hall.
Good morning.
All right, as you see in the memo, we've begun the work first planning process, and we're coming this morning to ask if we can remain a standard county. As we put in the memo, if we select to be an electing county, then the Board of Commissioners is basically responsible for the development, administration, and implementation of the Work First program. And if the funds are reduced or the caseloads increase, that means that the county is responsible for issuing and funding the Work First checks. If we remain a standard county, then the implementation and the responsibility of administering the program relies upon the Department of Social Services. If the caseloads increase or the funds decrease, then that becomes the responsibility of the state. So based upon those things, the economic status of the county, we're asking that we remain a standard county, and we just need your vote for that this morning.
Mm-hmm. I'll move.
Second.
Motion's made in second that we remain a standard county.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Uh-huh.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Do you also have a form filled out? Do I just give that to Pat or to you?
Thank you.
Next, we have the architect's contract facilities improvement project. Tim?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, good morning.
Good morning.
July 7th, we came to the board with a presentation on some facility needs that we had, or have actually. And at that time, this board selected the architect firm of Routon, Nicholson, and DeLuca to provide the architectural services for the Alamance County Facility Improvement Plan. This morning, I do have Lucian Routon and Charles Nicholson here from that firm, if you have any questions of them as we go through this process. What we're asking, and we had indicated at a meeting on July the 7th that we would bring a contract back to you for you to approve so that we could move forward with the design phase and then eventually the construction phase of this project. What we have before you today is the architect's contract for their services. How we got to this point, the architects with their engineers and with our staff went through and surveyed all of the facilities that are part of this plan to see what actually need to be done. Once they finished their assessment, then they put dollar amounts to that, And also, we ranked those projects 1 through 5 as to the things that need to be done, which were the most important, given them a 1, and the least important, 5. And this is actually in your attached to the contract there. The total cost of the projects, based on their assessment, came to be just something short of $15 million. So we went back through and pared that down to determine, to get it under the $10 million that we had requested before for approval, and to determine which of the projects that were the highest priority. And so we were able to pare it down to somewhat less than $10 million. So that's what we're actually asking for you to approve as a contract for those services today. If you look at your contract, I do want to highlight some of the things that are in there. If you'll go to Exhibit A, which is this document here, it follows your follows the initial part of the contract. They've gone through and listed each of the projects in here and listed, gave you a narrative as to the scope of work that would be done for each of those projects and associated costs related to that. That's in Exhibit A. If you look at it, Appendix 1, I know I'm jumping through this pretty quick. This is the more important part of it, probably. Appendix 1, which is the scope of work, and this lists all of the projects that they looked at. And it lists those that we are requesting that to move forward with and those that we are not requesting to move forward with because of the cost of funding. If you look at the first page inside of that document here, you'll notice as you go through that document, it lists each of the different projects. The first one that it lists is a Human Services Center. It goes through there and lists all of the different types of improvements that can be made. The ones that are highlighted in green are the ones that we're planning on moving forward with. We wanted to make sure that part of this project that we did take care of the structural issues to make sure that all of our facilities were sound. Some of the things that we've cut out were new carpet, ceiling tiles, painting, those types of things. So as you go through this appendix one here, each of the projects is listed. As you just thumb through there, you'll see again the items that are highlighted in green are the ones that we're proposing to move forward with. The ones that are in white we're not including as part of this scope of work. So it's got every one of the projects listed in there for you, so you'll know exactly what we're proposing to move forward with. If you go over to Exhibit B, which is this document here, it's a one page and it's got attached to the back of it an appendix also. This gives you a snapshot of all of the cost of the projects that we're looking at doing, the construction cost, the architect's fees, the owner cost, and then the total cost of the projects, which gets it under the $10 million. Again, that's Exhibit B, which is listed in the upper right-hand corner. The total cost of all of the projects that we're looking at doing as far as the construction cost is $8,624,988. The estimated design fee, which includes architect's fees, and then, of course, the architects will be hiring the engineers and other types of specialists that they need to assist them with the project. That total cost is $952,879. We'll be setting aside $172,500 for owner's cost and reserve, which is 2% of the project. And then the total cost of this project will be $9,750,367. Now, we will be going ahead and moving forward with borrowing $10 million. If we do not use all of that, then there's really two options. We can come back to this board and ask you, are there some of the projects that we initially did not think we were able to do, and can we use that money for those projects, or we can simply pay down the principal on the loan. So those will be kind of the two options that we can address at some point in the future. What we're looking at today is for you to go ahead and approve the contract with Arctech. We've got a lot of design work that has to be done in preparation for sending the bid packages out. So we have to get all that design work done first. They'll actually assist us with putting the bid packages together. We'll send those out to the prospective contractors for them to bid on. Once those bids come back, then we'll actually come back to you again in the future for you to actually award those contracts to move forward with the project. So that'll be done 6 months or so down the road. So I think the architects are still working on a time frame of this project, so we can get that back to you sometime in the future.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned prospective contractors.
Yes, ma'am.
Sending out packages to them.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, who would they be?
Well, we'll be doing a formal bid process, so anybody that wants to be part of that bid process
advertised.
Can be part. Yes, ma'am. It'll have to be. This will be a formal bid process, so it'll be advertised. So anybody that wants to wants a packet and wants to bid on this project will be able to. Yes. So it'll be up to anyone.
The architect's fee is how much?
The $952,879. And that does include the engineering costs that are associated with this, because there's a lot of design work that the engineers will do. There's some that the architects will do. The architects will actually, two of the projects, the courthouse project and the old DSS building, that they'll actually be overseeing that entire, those two projects entirely. So they'll be overseeing the construction of those also. A lot of the other things, if you, as you'll notice in the contract, such as roof repairs and paving, asphalt paving, they're going to help us with the specs for bidding processes, but their work on those will actually be somewhat limited once you get past that point. They'll still be assisting us, but they'll be somewhat limited.
What percentage of the work that's going to be done as far as what we're financing or borrowing is the architect's fees? What, 12%?
13%? About 10%.
About 10%.
Well, how much is the total? 800?
Well, the total cost of the project is $9.7 million.
Okay.
And of that, 952 is architects.
Well, subtract that out. I mean, you're below 900,000.
The construction phase of it's $8.6 million, and then we've got some cost ourselves that will incur. It's $172,000, so that gets you up to about 18.
Yeah. Is that standard?
Gets you up about $8.8 million.
Is that a standard architectural fee?
They can kind of address those issues on some other projects that they've done.
My name is Lucian Routon. On a project, these projects, for instance, the courthouse is a more complex than a normal job. You have to survey the entire building. You have to understand what all the construction is in advance. It's not like you're starting on a clean slate and you pick everything yourself and you just knock it out. There we have to do a lot of investigation prior to that. We have to prepare a set of drawings for the building because it's not like that. In many of the cases, we have to do site surveys. That's not normally included in basic services. Renovations particularly require more time during construction because, despite your best efforts, when you pull something off a wall and you look in there and all of a sudden you just see that there's more damage there than you expected, or there's something different than you were able to understand just with your eyes, it requires a lot more hand-holding up with the contractor to make sure things stay on schedule and to make decisions along the way. The design isn't just through the design process. A lot of the design takes place during construction because that's when you come upon issues that you just didn't know.
Well, I understand that. What I asked, my question was the fee, percentage of your fee.
We do a great deal of work like this for the Department of Administration, Department of Transportation. Our fees on projects like this range sometimes up to, believe it or not, 19%. On real complex jobs that have a lot of different players. In smaller jobs, sometimes the amount of work proportionate to the construction value is more than what you can actually get the job done for. So in some cases, on a small job, it's very hard to with, say, a 12% fee to even, you know, cover your costs. In some of these projects, probably 70-80% of our work will be just flow through us on out to other consultants. It takes money for them to, they generally charge a percentage. So these are in line as far as we, you know, in our experience working with the state of North Carolina, Duke University Medical Center, the city of Durham, the county of Durham, North Carolina State University, UNC. We did a project a few years ago for UNC. It was about a $10 million project. They paid us 12%. It was a medical renovation. It was very complex. It's just the nature of the amount of work it takes to get, you know, to do everything you need to do, and ultimately, if we've done a good job, we'll wind up saving you at times more than our entire fee. I mean, if we did a poor job, left the drawings sort of half, not fully tied down and anchored down, you could get chewed up during the construction process of being left open to change orders that would easily make up a difference between a percent in the in our fee. A percent of our fee is like one, you know, a difference in a 12% fee or a 13% fee or a 10% or 11. If you look at the cost of the project, that small percentage could endanger the $900,000 in construction, $9 million or $8.5 million worth of construction. Getting your full value out of that $8.5 million expenditure could be, well, jeopardized not only in construction, but in terms of its usefulness afterwards. Having a project that's either difficult to maintain, costs a lot of money and fuel costs, has repetitive repair cost associated with it. The long-term cost of a building can be four times or five times what it costs just to build it. And if it's not thought out thoroughly and carefully by an experienced firm, you can get, the stewardship is worrying about that $8.5 million and making sure you're getting your absolute most out of it. So we are a firm that has done this for 20 years, and the state of North Carolina trusts us, county of, city of Durham trusts us, Duke University trusts us. These are all fees that we typically charge.
I understand, but it does seem kind of odd that, to me, that we're doing $9 million worth of work, but we're paying $1 million for somebody to oversee it, for all intents and
purposes. Well, each job has...
To me, that's high.
A lot of trips. Well, I accept that, that's what you think, so... I mean, to us, we're making a lot of trips to a lot. We've already saved you money in some respects, in that some of these very small paving jobs, we've decided that the way to do it is to put them all in one big bundle. And I think that alone will save you money, and that will give you a contractor that's interested in doing something that small. It would be hard to get competitive prices on something that, a little paving, a little lot here and there. We're going to put them in one big bundle, the same with the roof. That way you get some real interest for some roofing and paving contractors that would come out, and then you can you get a lot of value there. Otherwise, you would not. Okay. So, we're trying our best to spend your money as effectively as if it were ours. That's the only way we've been able to come back and get work in the after, it's the only reason Duke University keeps using us after 21 years. We protect their money and their investment. So that's what we stand for.
Do they put your jobs out to bid?
They don't. They select us. We're not the only firm they select, but they select us depending on our availability and our reliability. And they ask us what the price is. The state of North Carolina, has a doesn't select on price. The state of North Carolina selects based on qualifications. And if the fee, then they leave it up to the state construction office to negotiate a fee with a particular design firm. To them, it's more valuable to get the best firm to do the job than to get the lowest cost firm. The lowest cost firm is going to leave you exposed during construction for change orders and bad work, or not oversee the work properly, or they don't have the experience to know what they're doing. So for professional design services, it's the national norm, the state norm, and is to find the firms that have the most qualifications to plan the remainder of the work. And the money you're spending, the vast majority of it is $8.5 million on hard items. That's where you want to be sure that you're getting your money's worth.
Just one quick question about the courthouse. To me, that's the big project, obviously. What is your estimation of the longevity of the courthouse once we complete this work?
Oh, I'd say you could get, you'll still need, replacement mechanical systems might last 30 years, 40 years, but the building, if the structure's maintained and we don't let water infiltrate it and damage it, it could last another 50 years.
Just 50?
Well, it's lasted, well, I mean, you know, any building takes money to maintain. The money you spend now, that building has been needing some repair for some time. It could go on another 100, 200 years if it's properly maintained. I mean, you know, any building, and now in today's world, that's what people need to be doing more of, is maintaining existing buildings. And that's pretty much been a big part of our work. We just finished, Charles just won an award for renovating an old building in Raleigh. It was called the Old Health Building. It's just two blocks down from the legislature. And the brick was falling apart. The mortar was falling apart. We had, and this was something during construction, we had to, the building was painted with, When we told the contractor to take the brick off, as he took the brick off, all the mortar just fell out. The brick, the paint was holding the mortar in. And during construction, we had to determine, we tried three different methods to, with different degrees of aggressiveness to take off the paint without ruining the mortar. We finally had to tuck point the entire building. But it looks beautiful now. We had to put an elevator that served the basement. The pit didn't even go down to the basement. So we had to dig down below the existing footings of the building, put in an elevator pit, make the building accessible to all floors. We redid the roof. It was a slate roof. It had turn metal finishes. I'm going on here, but anyway, I mean, there's a lot of work that in projects like this. So I know it seems, you know, it may seem high. It would not, none of our clients would bat an eye, I mean, frankly, at these fees. The clients that we're used to working with, like, And these are people that watch money every day for a living. Facility departments that are constantly hiring people, and they, you know, would not hire someone if they felt like they were getting gouged.
I understand.
I think you answered my question just a moment ago, but you do have experience with historic buildings.
The building that Charles did was a historic building. We did a building over here in Elon that was on the historic register, wasn't it, the Johnson Hall, got a state preservation award for that. It's something we've been doing for 20 years, so we're very, you know, I feel confident that we, you know, we can handle any of the issues that would arise in this and give you a building that you'll be proud of.
Once you get started, how often would one of you gentlemen be on site as it progresses?
During construction, we'll probably be over here at least once a week. There are some of the projects won't require our exact, I mean, they'll require the presence, say, in the roofing. We'll have a roofing consultant over here. For the paving, we'll have somebody over here to evaluate the contractor's performance in that. We'll have regular progress meetings, much like we had for the EMS building, weekly meetings where we sit down with the contractor, hammer out any issues that he has, any questions he has. When you're looking at marshaling a contractor's forces that can be 20 or 30 different firms with people that are working for them with all degrees of experience, and they're all trying to get to the site and do things, mistakes happen. I mean, you know, and it takes a real team with the contractor, the owner, and the design team working together to steer that boat through that water until you get, you know, into the harbor at the end. It's a very collaborative process.
That EMS building went pretty smoothly.
Yeah, it did.
Okay, any further questions?
I think we got some major renovations going to go on at the courthouse, haven't we, Lucian?
We do. It's going to be a magnificent building. I mean, I think it'll be a proper symbol for the county when it's done. And, you know, perhaps these meetings can be taking place there. So, I mean, we're really excited about that.
Okay.
If I can just elaborate on that a little bit more. If you look at Exhibit B, where it does break down the cost of all these projects and it does break down the architect's fee, it does list a percentage in there for each project that we're doing as part of this overall project. If you look at the Appendix 1 that's attached to that Exhibit B, it goes through and gives you quite a bit of detail as to what type of services that the architect will be providing. It goes through and breaks it down by project also, starting on page 3. It's 9 pages of explanation as to what their services would be. And it does go through each of the projects, explains in detail what's going to be done, what type of services they'll be providing, what types of services the engineers will be providing, all of that. So that should give you some more, some backup information that will hopefully help you feel a little bit more comfortable with what they're proposing to charge.
Of the $10 million that we were originally shown,
yes, sir,
for the projects, are we, I don't know how to phrase this, and you're saying that we have another analysis showing 15?
That's correct.
Okay. excuse me. are any of the, again, I can't phrase this, of the $10 million we looked at for the original projects, how much supposedly are those 10? Is the 15 just for those 10, or was that for more stuff?
Some of it was more stuff. When the architects and engineers came out and did their assessments of all of the facilities, they discovered some things that we initially did not see. So those were added in. There may be some and there's some other things that were added in that are still in there in the $10 million projects. But a lot, they discovered some things as they went through that when we had done the assessment, we did not see ourselves. Is that correct?
That's correct, and there were some additional requests when we met with individual users. I mean, some, you know, I need a building here, I need this, and we said, all right, we'll take note of that, and we took note of it, and then in the long run, those great projects just did not make the cut, you know, and it's, you know, we only got so much money, you can only spend so much, so we just, you know, we gave you our unvarnished opinion with us, with some very experienced engineers and landscape architects and civil engineers, and just said, guys, you need to make some hard decisions. And they did. And we helped them. We prioritized it. Be nice to have that. But, I mean, I still think what you're going to be spending will be a vast improvement, and it'll be a good stewardship of the facilities that you all have charge of. Some of them are, you know, just, boy, they really like to have a building up here to take care of some of the equipment behind the DSS building. Well, that wasn't on the list.
But the original projects are still below 10, right?
The original projects. Well, no, the original projects, the from the 10 to the 15 million, that included some of the original stuff, and so we had to, and I'm not sure which ones that would be, but I'm sure that some of the original stuff that we were looking at doing did push it over the 10 million once they came in and did their assessment. Now, what we tried to do was make sure we were trying to balance two things: keep the total cost of the projects under 10 million, and then also make sure that what we were doing is making all of our facilities structurally sound. And so we're trying to balance those two things.
Last question. I know I'm beating this to death, but we only have one shot at you, okay? On the terracotta on that courthouse, what can be done to make it last longer, or have you worked with terracotta before? And
in some cases, for instance, in the project Charles did, in some cases, we rework, if there's an internal gutter, we can rework that and salvage some of the tile, whether it's terracotta or slate or whatever, and you develop new tile, you develop some spare tile that you can then come back and repair other things. The terracotta in that building, there is terracotta that you can buy and you can probably and match pretty well. Terracotta is a 1,000-year-old product. I mean, you know, it will, or I mean, it's a product that can last 1,000 years if it's properly maintained.
You're talking about the outside?
Yeah, I'm talking about the outside.
The limestone. The terracotta, I thought you were talking about the roof.
Well, terracotta on the side, the whole side of the whole building is terracotta.
Yeah, it's a mixture of limestone and terracotta. And the
terracotta is damaged by water, so the most important thing is to get the water off the building. So that's what we'll be looking at, a waterproofing consultant who is also a masonry consultant. We'll be looking at all that, coming up with a plan for making sure that we keep the water off it. And any repair or restoration work that's done, we'll also have a terracotta specialist there who will be telling us this piece we'll have to trash and we can replicate it with a new one, or this piece we can keep. It's painstaking to go through it piece by piece.
Now, if the board would like for us to move forward with the entire $15 million, we'll be glad to, but we're really just asking for the $10 million today, so don't put you on the spot.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we approve the contract with the architectural firm.
I'll say.
Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Manager, I understand the jail report has been renewed.
Yes.
Okay. Next is the tax matters. Kim?
Good morning. The tax collector is required by statute to give an annual settlement to the governing body. And in accordance with that statute, I am here this morning to report or provide settlement of our tax year 2007 taxes. The charges that were charged to the collector for collecting, including discoveries and any abatements and rollback taxes, totaled $69,468,032.70. We deposited $66,805,678.66, leaving uncollectible for real and personal property of $1,231,455.44 and registered motor vehicles $1,430,898.60. That is for the current year 07 taxes. For the delinquent years, 1998 through 2006, there was a total of $4,329,049.67 of uncollected taxes at the beginning of July 1, 07. After adjustments and payments, the uncollected balance is $2,165,358.64. After the board approves the settlement report, the 07 taxes that are uncollected are recharged back to the collector as delinquent taxes, and then requests the board to charge the collector with collecting of the 2008 taxes. They legally become due today, September 1st, but our taxpayers have received discounts for early payments received for the month of August.
Kim, what's the status on the legislation to require people to pay their automobile tax when they renew their...
Right. There were some amendments to the legislature this year to allow the funds that had been collected in order to establish the software and the means to make this happen. When the legislature was first enacted, they failed to allocate those funds. So they collected the money but had no way of getting the money. So that was taken care of with this session. Right now, the target date is January 2011, when the motor vehicle taxes will be collected at the time a tag is purchased or renewed.
All right. Do we have a motion to accept the settlement of the tax collector?
Motion.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? In order of the tax collector.
The next item is the charge off of 1998 taxes.
No, I'm sorry. Just a second.
Yes, sir.
Did we do the order?
I have them attached together as one.
Okay.
Is that acceptable?
It's on the back page. Yeah.
We actually only voted on the settlement. I make a motion that we accept the order of the tax collectors. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Thank you. Sorry about jumping ahead. The 1998 taxes, by statute of limitations, the tax collector can no longer enforce collection procedures on taxes after they become 10 years past due. That 10-year date is September 1st, 2008 for the 1998 taxes. We can certainly accept payments if any taxpayers wish to come in and pay their taxes, but experience has showed that usually enforced procedures is pretty much how we collect our delinquent taxes. And as of today, we can no longer enforce the collection of 1998 taxes.
That mainly all of them?
That's all, yes, sir. Mm-hmm. But right now, the accounts receivable for the 98 taxes, $106,037.13. So I request the board approve charging off the uncollected 1998 property taxes.
Have a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Appointment of the deputy tax collector.
The general statute requires the governing board of county commissioners to appoint a deputy collector for the term to be determined by the governing board. The deputy tax collector, shall have the same authority to perform under the direction of the tax collector any act that the tax collector may perform unless the governing body appointing the deputy specifies limits to the scope of the duties authority. Therefore, I am requesting Amy Perkins, who has served the past year as the deputy tax collector, be reappointed as deputy tax collector. This gives Amy the signature authority to enforce garnishments, bank attachments, and other enforced collection procedures.
Okay. Do we have a motion to reappoint Amy?
Motion.
Second.
Okay. Motion second. Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. And schedule values?
Okay. Now comes the big book.
Kim, before you go ahead with that, I don't know if this is the appropriate time to ask. A year ago, that you put a notice in with the tax bill for people at a certain age receiving a certain income would have a reduction in their property taxes.
Yes, ma'am.
It did not come out this year. Could I ask why? Because I've been attacked.
No, ma'am.
And I referred them to you.
No, ma'am. We did not include that mailing this year. But anyone who comes in, we certainly do go through the process and the application process and encourage them to apply for that exemption. There is a new, it's not really an exemption, but a new tax senior citizen program available that's going to come into effect July 1st of 2009, which will be about the same time of revaluation. New property values come in. And I would like to prepare a report outlining this program and present to the commissioners possibly later on in the fall around October or something about the new program that's designed to provide relief for our senior citizens in addition to the exemption that's already available.
Okay. I did not save that notice from last year.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have a copy of that I might pick up?
Certainly.
I will be meeting at Canoodle Center next week, and they are anxious.
Yes, ma'am. Certainly. I'll be glad to get you one.
Thank you.
Okay. Schedule values. The statute is 105.317. Directs the tax assessor to prepare and present to the Board of Commissioners a uniform schedule of valued standards and rules to be used in appraising real property at its true value and at its present use value, and that this book is significantly detailed to enable those making the appraisers to adhere to them in appraising the real property. Now, your books obviously aren't there in front of you. They're over there by Amy, and if you want to pick one up as you leave. As you thumb through the books, there's 31 sections. We talk in detail about the appraisal theory, property valuation techniques. We have examples of all our data, inventory forms, property record cards, the rates that'll be used to determine the value of property. The primary three approaches to value are the cost approach, the sales approach, and the income approach. The cost approach is most widely used on all properties and is reflected in the property record card, and there will be an example of a property record card in the book. Sales comparison approach is used as a backup to support the cost approach, and there is also a section in the manual that gives you an example of some sample sales that we have looked at. The income approach is used primarily on income-producing properties, shopping centers, apartment buildings, and so forth, and you will find an example of that approach to value also. Our land use schedules are contained within the report. These rates will be used to assign use value to all our farmers and our forestry and agricultural properties that are under the use value program. We have our code of ethics from the IAAO, the standards on mass appraisals from IAAO, and the uniform standards of professional appraisal practice, standard 6, which deals with the mass appraisal of properties. There's terms and definitions provided within the manual, so if you don't understand the term that we may use, you should be able to make reference to that term. We've also identified the appeals process, what happens after we send out the revaluation notices, and then also the resolution in which the Board of Commissioners established a Board of Equalization and Review. Now, what happens now, the schedule values are presented this morning to the board members. We will have a set of the schedules in my office for the public to review. There'll also be one in the county manager's office available for public review and inspection. Today, what I ask the board is to set a public hearing tentatively for the 15th, if it's the board's pleasure, September 15th, on the schedule values. After we have the public public input session, then we will proceed to adopt the schedule values that will be used for our revaluation effective January 1, 2009.
We got that set to adopt at the October 6th meeting, right?
Yes, sir. After they're adopted, and then they, taxpayers or citizens, will have 30 days from October 6th to appeal to the Property Tax Commission the schedule values or anything within contained within the schedules that they wish to appeal. So that's correct, yes, sir.
Right. We'll have the public hearing on September the 15th and then adopt the values at the next board meeting October 6th.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Do we have a motion to set the public hearing for the 15th? Okay, there's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
And one last note, we will be advertising, running legal notice in the paper that the schedules are available for public inspection. Thank you.
Okay, next we have the offer purchase agreement. Mr. Albright.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm appearing before you today on behalf of the landfill. We have an offer purchase agreement into the Eagle. On the screen, I believe you have a small map before you. It is a offer to purchase. We're asking the commissioners to approve so we can go forward and close at a later date. We're purchasing 112 acres, which is the large blue tract, and then we're also purchasing a 1.84 acre strip down the side and the home of the Ingolds, which fronts on Bethlehem Saxpahaw Church Road. The Ingolds have asked us, as part of this agreement, they're both elderly and they're in ill health, to allow them to stay in their residence until they die or move on to another location. So we propose entering into a life estate with these two folks that allow them to stay in their home. And then upon their death, then the county will, landfill will
will own the house and the little strip, which gives us access, two points of access to the property, one on Bethlehem Church Road and one on Austin Quarter Road. The purchase price is $5,000 an acre for the 112.96 acre tract. That comes to about $560,000. The purchase price for the house, we used our tax appraisal value, and that came to $55,183.
Where's the house at in regards to?
On the picture there, it's at the top of the picture. Oh yeah, a little laser beam here. So I make this thing work without putting anybody's eye out. The house is right here. And then this little strip right here will be used for the entrance to the property.
Are you familiar with the controversy up at Mount Airy about a similar situation with their landfill? And
No, I'm not.
It's unbelievable. There was an elderly couple, and I can't give you all the details, but it was in Mount Airy, Surrey County. And it had something to do with the landfill, had something to do with an elderly couple. And the county had to, well now, the last I heard, they were going to evict them. Now, I haven't followed up to see what happened, but something went wrong with the negotiations. So I hope we'll look into that maybe and see.
Well, we've treated these people very well. We didn't threaten them.
Oh, I realize that.
Not that.
We just don't want to have that come up like Mount Airy did.
Right.
20 years from now.
I think Greg and
I. It sounds like he's already got it worked out.
I hope so.
Legally.
The farms right here, all of this is planted in corn and tobacco and soybean. And Mr. Ingold has requested that we continue to allow those farmers that he has leased his property to continue to plant. And I believe, Greg.
You want me to pass these out?
Yes, please. He's got smaller maps for you to look at. But
thanks.
We think it would be better to keep this under cultivation.
Houses,
it keeps trespassers off.
That's right.
And it provides a buffer from the landfill down. I don't want to take off Richard's head here. Buffer from the landfill from smoke and traffic and noise and those type of things.
Thank you.
The city of Greensboro got into a little bit of trouble because they took their landfill buffer and built low-income housing on it. And then they ended up closing their landfill. We don't want to do that. We have property owners that have offered to sell their property to us. We'd like to enter into a agreement with them. Funding's coming from the landfill.
Enterprise
fund. So we would ask for a resolution approving this offer to purchase and instructing us to go forward and arrange a closing. There is one other condition I want to point out on page 3, condition number 4. We've asked the Ingalls to consult a tax attorney, since they've owned this property for so long, to allow them to maybe enter into some type of property exchange. It will save them a little tax money.
Let me add one thing to this purchase offer, and Brian, you may want to join in on this. Brian says that with the purchase of this land and the amount that it costs, he is going to apply for a $500,000 grant from the state, which could be used to build a gym on that property, probably on that area right across from the entrance to the landfill or somewhere along there, wherever it'll perk the best. And he's in dire need of gym space, and hopefully this can serve more than one purpose.
It's we're hoping to be able to take advantage if the county does spend its own funds. We like to try to look at ways to leverage that. One point that we have discussed is the possibility of using the expenditure of funds from Landfill Enterprise to secure his property. I was trying to leverage that into the construction of some gymnasium down here that would satisfy the desire for having a gym in the Sykes Ball area. I think the board's been approached about that in the past, as well as meet that need for that area. It is growing. If we can pull it off and do it in a way that doesn't, the county doesn't incur extra expense, it'd be a pretty big windfall. So we obviously would want to work with Greg and Clyde to go out and take a look at the property, see if it's feasible to do. I have mentioned this to the Recreation Advisory Commission, and they understand the need for indoor space and very supportive of it. So at our next meeting, we're going to nail down which part of the application. We have several that are kind of in a queue that we're thinking about, but once we learn about this opportunity, it really pushes it to the front. So we'll be working closely with Clyde and Greg.
Good.
Very good.
What's the county's planned use for the property? For cover for the landfill? Or?
Just buffer. Buffer for the landfill to keep people from building houses too close to it so we don't run into a situation where people complaining about heavy trucks passing by every day and dust and all that type of thing.
It could, Mr. Sharp, possibly down the road be used as soil as we enter the final stages, which is about 65 years out. I want to add that. We currently have 90 acres under footprint for landfill disposal, so we're in really good shape.
I know the county's been looking for some time for adjoining property, so can we y'all put this together?
Yeah. Just for the sake of information, please.
Yes, sir.
Check the Mount Airy situation and see how that came out and if there's anything possible.
Believe that it also involved the city of Winston-Salem.
Oh, it was nasty. It was all over. It was in all the papers, eminent domain, and a couple. I mean, they were in view. Their land was in view of Pilot Mountain. And it was a nasty deal. And they had the public showed up at commissioner meetings just raising Cain. And the because they were feeling sorry for the elderly people. Something went awry somewhere. And I just wonder, I'd like to know from what
research on that.
Yes, sir.
Could I ask you a question, too? How is it going down there with vehicles coming down to you folks that are contained or covered?
I think there's a drastic improvement in that.
I'm seeing it on the streets, but I don't know if I'm just not in the right places.
Right. I'm pretty pleased with that so far.
So it's going so far so good. Anything we can do to help?
I think we're going in the right direction. I don't know that we'll ever completely eradicate that, but I think we're moving in the right direction. We certainly appreciate your efforts with your letter.
Anything more we can do? Anything more we can do?
No, ma'am, not at this point. I do have some things that I'm thinking about down the road. Possibly, and I haven't spoken with Sheriff Johnson, but possibly subsidizing a position that would that could patrol areas. So with landfill funds, I know this is new, but this is something that I have tossed around.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Next, we have the budget amendment number 17.
Yeah, motion on that, Mr.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sure. We have a motion to.
Motion.
Go ahead. The purchase agreement, and we have a motion to second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next, budget amendment on the WIC program. Mr. Bass?
Sure. Thanks, sir. Just to let you all know, we have gotten some good news that we are in receipt of an additional $67,540 in our Women, Infants, and Nutrition Supplemental and Children's Supplemental Nutrition Program. And these funds were not anticipated at the time that the 2008-2009 budget was developed. This, as you all know, is a federally funded program which is state administered. It requires no local match, and in order to receive the funds, the individuals have to be residents of Alamance County. So we'd like to put this before you and request that we allow to spend these funds.
I'll make the motion. We accept.
Second.
Okay, motion second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Mr. Bass.
Yes, ma'am.
What's the definition of a resident?
Someone whose residence shows up that they live in this county.
All right. I bring you a water bill, and that proves I'm a resident.
Or the purposes
of a certain period of time.
For the purpose of this program, yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Hey, Mr. Manager.
Commissioners, some housekeeping first on the matter of I think the gentleman who raised the issue on 287G program, rather than that coming up at the on the meeting of the 19th, it probably should fall back into October. So if he's still here. You received, I think, in your packet a notice from me concerning that the rains that we had last week in the Fire Marshal's office and emergency management, the good job that they did during that period of time. And just my understanding that they are preparing now for another hurricane, Hannah, which may be coming in to us.
It's targeted here, right? Between
yes, sir.
South Carolina and North Carolina.
Yes, sir.
According
to Piedmont.
The department and staff really did a good job last week in that we had a lot of flooding, but they were prepared and everything turned out very well. The as you know, Joyce, our HR director, resigned effective last Friday. We have hired a new HR director. Joyce made it her final project to rush through advertising and interviewing, and we found an excellent prospect who actually lives in Burlington but works in Greensboro, and she will be coming in September 22nd, I believe, to take over. So we're in good shape there.
Who is it?
You want her name?
Yeah.
Sherry Hook, H-O-O-K. She's in the private industry. About 3 years ago, when I was interviewing for the position of county manager, I promised you that I could give you 3 to 4 years as county manager. Come December 31, 2008, that promise will have been met with almost 3.5 years. And with your permission, of course, I would like to put in notice of retirement for that date, December 31, 08. And I want to, first of all, thank you, commissioners, for the opportunity. It's been an exciting time. It's been a very interesting time. I've had a ball, probably the most exciting 3 years so far in my 40-year career. And it's been a lot of fun, and I've always told the other department heads, when it's not any fun, you need to find something else to do, and it's been a lot of fun. I don't really want to retire at this time, but I think it's time. And it's very important in business or any kind of career to know when it's time to go. And let me also add, I have no regrets whatsoever. I've also been your attorney for 12 years. So I've been here a long time. I've had a great time. Alamance County is getting ready to go through, and it has been going through, but it's getting ready to go through a very exciting time. $10 million construction that you just approved, the 800 megahertz communication system that's coming in. Wish I could be here to be around when all of that's going on, because it's going to be a very exciting time. But let me tell you, in finishing that jail, we started about 3 years ago. I'm not sure that I would want to go through anything like that again. It's quite an experience. I knew it was going to be a hard time. I didn't know exactly how hard it was going to be. But the day that I turned the keys over to the sheriff was one wonderful day. Sammy Epps and I were totally exhausted. And I did think about retiring at that point. I think I talked to the chairman about that at one point, because it was something else. But it has been totally worth it. The sheriff brought in, for the first full year, he brought in revenue of $6 million on that jail. That's about half of what it cost in the first year. So your decision to go forward with the jail expansion was a good one, and I think will prove to be. And let me just add, everybody said, you know, that the sheriff has tried to fill it up with illegal aliens. Well, I know for a fact that he can fill it up with Marshall prisoners, he can fill it up with prisoners from Guilford County or anywhere else. It's a good investment, And I've had calls from at least three other county managers whose counties are building jails, and they have run into the same problem that Alamance ran into. And that is, the contractor would get to a certain point and no progress was made, and on and on and on and on. So we were not the only ones, and they called me wanting to know what to do, and I can only tell them what we did. What they did do, I have no idea. I've just given you a list of some of the progress that we've made during the last 3 years. And let me add, from the very beginning, I do not take credit for this. It was from your direction that all of this took place, and it was the sweat, time, and leadership of these department heads who got the job done. In completing the jail, and that was the major project, and that was what I told you would be the major project when you interviewed me. The sheriff and Sammy and I had some knockdown, drag out fights and disagreements, but we always came to a good result at the end, and he ended up doing what I said we were going to do. That's not true, and you know it. And let me say that in that room, the manager's office, poor Pat, she probably was not ready for what went on during that period of time, because there was a lot of noise that came out of that room and a lot of language that she probably hadn't ever heard. I was threatened with being thrown out of the window on many occasions, and finally told the individual they didn't have to throw me out, I was going to jump out of the window. And if it had gone on much longer, I would have jumped out of the window. I can guarantee you that. Like I say, though, it was certainly worth it.
Do you reckon that window was high enough to take care of the problem?
Only if I hit on my head. leaving is very satisfying, and for the reason it's satisfying, the jail was completed. The revenue is coming in as you anticipated that it would be. We have a new EMS center. We have a state-of-the-art communication system that's going in. The old courthouse will be restored, which you just approved. The Family Justice Center will be coming. More parks in the county. More ambulances are on the road. More deputies are protecting the citizens of this county. I think Alamance County has definitely moved into the 21st century. Again, it's your leadership and these department heads who did it. You know, there in the last 3 years, and I don't want the department heads to forget, I still have about four more months, with your permission, of course. But it's been rough at times. I've been threatened. I've been stalked. I've been maligned by the press. I've been called a little tyrant. By the press. I don't know what a little tyrant is as opposed to a big tyrant, but I accept that. I don't have any grudges or anything like that. Now, my little mother had problems reading a lot of those things in the newspaper, but hopefully she'll get over it. And I'm sure at times you had a lot of questions about what I was doing and whether or not I had lost my mind or age had crept up on me faster than I thought it had. But again, I still have no regrets. The decisions I made, I think, were sound. The county is fiscally sound. We have a great cadre of department heads, most of whom I was fortunate to appoint. We have a great group of employees who are very dedicated. I think succession, if you gentlemen want to, and lady want to do it, succession to the positions that I hold are certainly within your grasp in the county at this time. The assistant county manager and the assistant county attorney are both capable of taking over either as an interim position or permanently. I think they are very well qualified, and I certainly recommend both of them. for the job. Of course, that is your decision and your decision only. I'm very proud of the department heads who do an outstanding job. I've never been one to micromanage, so they're the ones who do it. And unless they have a problem, they don't see me. But if they do, a door's always been open. I've had an open door policy from the very beginning. So let me just say that I received Sammy Epps's notice of his retirement last Friday. And Sammy is retiring finally on the 31st of December also, after 48 years with the county. But I could not have.
How many years?
At least 48.
Well, I didn't think he was that old.
That's what he tells everybody. I could not have done the job without Sammy Epps. I'll tell you right up front now. He has been a good friend and an outstanding steward for the county. He's done a tremendous job. He has saved the county thousands and thousands of dollars in construction costs because of his knowledge and leadership. Sammy always liked to say that he and I made a great good cop, bad cop combination. But quite frankly, I didn't think Sammy was that bad anyway. Amy, I know, what else can you say? She keeps the county together physically and has done an outstanding job. I had to make all kind of promises for Amy to even take the position of finance officer, and she's fulfilled everything that I ask. I don't know that I fulfilled everything that that she has asked. Of course, Dot and Pat and I worked together 12 years. Dot's been with me 20-some years, so could not have done it without that. And I think most people and the department heads at least know very shortly after they become department heads, the county's run by Pat and Dot, and I recognized that a long time ago. That's why we get along fine, and the county keeps going along. Very good, and I didn't mean to talk so long. I didn't think it was this long, but you know, government is interesting. Let me close by reading something that was taken from a speech in 1999, I think describes the way I look at public service, and I think you do too. And the speaker said, "Enter public life determined to tell the truth, to put problem solving ahead of partisanship, to defend the public interest against the special interest, to risk your personal ambitions for the sake of country and the ideals that make her great. Keep your promise to America, and you will keep your honor. You will know a happiness far more sublime than pleasure." And that's what it's all about. That was made by Senator John McCain in 1999. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
David, we certainly appreciate your service over the last 3 years. And county managers serve from meeting to meeting, and I know it's a volatile job sometimes. And you've caused me heartburn a few times along the way, but I have to say that I think the department heads have grown to respect you and admire you. I get good feedback from a lot of county employees about your job performance, good. And like I say, I think they support you as a group. I think you, under your leadership, we probably have accomplished a lot of things on here that we would not have accomplished if we'd have had a different manager. I think we made a lot of good progress in those 3 years. And for one, I want to thank you for your service. I kind of like you feel like you know when the time is right to go, and I'm sure the new board will make the decision on the new manager. Like you say, you know, we have internal candidates, I think, that are qualified also, but I won't have a say-so in that. But I appreciate the team you have built and to lead us on in the future. But personally, I just want to thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I certainly appreciate the job you've done. I know the department heads that you have brought on and those that have stayed with us are doing an outstanding job in regards to keeping the spending down and providing the services. And I thank all of you for that. And don't sell yourself short. There's a lot of things that are not in this list of accomplishments of the county. I know the relationship between the school board and the schools and the county, they just at the last meeting said it's the best it's been in years, and a lot of that comes from you, and we certainly appreciate that. The fact that, you know, as we figure the budget, the importance of the supplement and the fact that it has increased 60%, you know, just in the last 4 years, and retention, we're seeing teacher retention now. We're seeing SAT scores going up. That was just recently we saw that in the paper, integrated testing. So it is working. It is working, and a lot of that's because of the relationship you have with Dr. Bridges and the school board, and I certainly appreciate that.
Thank you, Mr. Vice.
Sammy, we appreciate your service.
Yes, sir.
I can't believe it's been that long, but
36
years. Okay, all right. You've been a very valuable asset to the county for 36 years. You better get a good replacement for the inspections job. I know that's a tough one to do. But,
how'd you keep your hair? That's what I want.
I used to be black-headed.
Let me say, speaking for the commissioners, that we appreciate everything that the managers of the departments are doing, and we really appreciate it. We appreciate you putting up with David all these years, and the commissioners, and all the things that you do, including you too, Sam.
Okay. Consent agenda. If there's no objection, I'll move that items A, B, and C be approved. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Just one thing before we go. The State Association has prepared a 2008 State of the Counties report, and this is something they will update annually. It will also be on their website. This has about 48 different areas where you can compare county to county. This is part of their State Association just turned 100 years old, and this is one of the projects they wanted completed for that centennial anniversary. But later this year, you can go on their website and you could compare up to three counties against each other in about 48 different areas of performance. So this is going to be a really good resource. They're providing each county with two copies of this in the meantime. You want to pass that down? Maybe Tim wants to look at it. But it's an excellent publication that they come out with.
Mr. Chairman, we have the photographers here to take your
pictures. Okay, we will have a photo of the board after the meeting. Is there any other announcements? If not, meeting's adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners' meeting.